So, a warm welcome to all for this the session on introduction to DSP lab. With madam and myself, like lab in charges for this DSP subject, theory subject. Parallelly, we also have the lab for the same. And earlier, we thought of May in the month of October, we start with the offline classes, but it not happened so till now. And let us make our students to little bit comfortable with respect to lab, and so that whatever we teach in the theoretical perspective, so that you can able to do it on your own at the place where you are, and practice the same during your free hours. So in that perspective, we thought of giving you a small demonstration on the MATLAB tool. So I request Vijaya ma'am, the professor and head of the department, to address you in this regard. Ma'am, over to you, ma'am.
Yes. Okay. Good morning, all the students, and good morning to Kotresh sir. Me and Kotresh sir, as sir said, we are handling DSP for fifth semester this time, and it has got a parallel lab session also. So this should have happened from September 1st, but now it has not happened. So let us start with the lab session. As much as possible, let us try to make you understand the lab sessions. The lab session will run on MATLAB, and DSP, whatever theory you would have learnt, everything is there in the lab session also. Such as, for example, you have studied in the first chapter DFT and its property and its application as far as filtering is concerned. So these three topics will be covered in the lab session also. In the upcoming days, in DSP theory, we will be covering the filtering techniques. So same thing will be there in the lab session also. So for this, you should know the theory behind the lab session. Okay, so concentrate fully on the class sessions, not to miss anything, and repeatedly you can listen to our recorded lectures. So that is one advantage I am seeing through these online classes. So then you have to practice the MATLAB programming. We will be suggesting you books. Maybe as and when required, we'll be suggesting you the textbooks also. As of now, textbook that you can refer for MATLAB programming is SK Mitra. It has got lots of MATLAB programs solved. So you can simply type them and see if you are getting the result, whatever he would have explained in the book. Now, I request Kotresh sir to brief all the students regarding the MATLAB and its usage. Some of you may be familiar with the MATLAB usage, but it has to be compulsorily known to all the students. So, Kotresh sir will make you to understand how to write the MATLAB program and what are the loops available in it, how to declare the variable, is there any is it not read required at all, how it differs from C programming, how it is similar to C programming. Everything will be taken up now by Kotresh sir. Kotresh sir, can you please continue?
Yes ma'am, thank you very much ma'am for briefing about. Thank you ma'am. We'll start the session shortly. I'll just present my screen. Just give me an acknowledgement. So once you are able to see the screen. I hope the screen is visible to all.
Yes, we can see the screen.
Thank you, ma'am.
What about students?
Yes, ma'am.
Kotre sir, you hide that bar that is appearing on the screen. Share, stop sharing. Hatra on the hide anti dela. That you have to click.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine.
Okay, welcome you all for this introduction to Digital Signal Processing Lab. Once again, I thank Vijaya ma'am for briefing about this lab. And this course is...
Have you started recording?
Yes, ma'am. It is on. It is on. This course is for the lab session is for the 1.5 credits and the course code goes like this. 18UECL, I'm sorry, it is 505. Not 505, and the prerequisite is yes, obviously the signal science systems, and these are the I'll quickly go through the I don't take much time over here. Just quickly go through, get you through this course learning objectives, and followed by which all the lab experiments that we have for this semester, and then I'll quickly shift to the MATLAB. Hands-on session. So this course enables the students to get the practical approach with respect to signal processing, such as like realization of the filters and right from the fundamentals of the analyzing the signals, various signals like step input, impulse functions, and followed by we try to design a simple filters. All the realization of those system on the hardware, that is what this particular subject mainly deal with here, and these are the outcomes of this particular lab course where the student will be able to manipulate the different type of signals, and they he or she could able to understand how actually the convolution and how to obtain the DFT and inverse DFT. In the theory we know how to make a hand calculation for a given endpoint DFT, but the same thing how I can able to write a simple program and how to obtain the DFT of a given signal. That's what we will try to learn in this particular lab, and followed by we also studied about few of the properties in with respect to discrete Fourier transform, like the convolution property, circular convolution property, and Parseval's theorem. All these properties are going to be verified and using the MATLAB scripting, and followed by we have analog and digital filters, where some specifications will be given to students. By looking into specifications, students are able to should able to write a simple program and see to that how the filter, analog filter works and digital filter works. So these are the few outcomes of this particular course. At the end of this semester, you will able to go through all these types of right from the signal manipulations to till designing the digital filter. We'll get to know about how to write a simple program and how to analyze the signals. So these are the contents that for this particular lab. So right from, as I told you, right from basic signal processing, followed by how to see the linear time invariant systems, the response of the linear time invariant systems. That's where we go for convolution and deconvolution operation and circular convolution and computation of discrete Fourier transform and obtaining its inverse, and again verification of the properties. Frequency analysis of signals using DFT. This is one of the application where we use DFT to analyze the frequency analysis of a given signal. Then already for your division, we already it is covered with respect to overlap add and overlap save. That is what the linear filtering of a long data sequence using DFT, and efficient calculation. That's what the fast Fourier transform or கேட்கலாம் மேம் இல்ல மேம் ஸ்டூடெண்ட்ஸ் ஐ மை ஆடிபிள் ஓ இன்டர்நெட் டிஸ்கனெக்ட் ஆகிதா மேம் நான்
முடிக்கிறேன் கேளு மேம் நான் சொல்றது மாதிரி வந்து சார் நீங்க டீச்சர்
I think this slide was covered in the last few minutes before, where we start with the course outcomes, like students will be able to come up with a simple, he or she could able to write a simple MATLAB programming right from signal manipulations. When I say that signal manipulations, it is nothing but your step input function and the delta function, right from that particular level I'm talking about, until you can able to compute the responses of a linear time invariant systems convolution, for example. And also we in the theoretical aspects, we know how to solve a simple discrete Fourier transform, to calculate discrete Fourier transform x of k when x of n is given. Same thing, we will try to write a simple MATLAB program to verify it using the scripting language. So again, we try to obtain different properties on MATLAB, where in the theory you already learned about a few of the properties, like convolution property and a circular convolution, time shift and frequency shift, and the Parseval's theorem. All these properties are going to be verified using MATLAB, where we try to write a program. Main thing here is you should, a student should know how to write a program, for which to write a program you should have a strong background of a theoretical knowledge. Okay, so again, moving further, we have two more important concepts here. One is designing the analog filters, and another one is design of the digital filters. So once again, you should have a strong theoretical knowledge on designing these analog and digital filters. We will be given with a few specifications. You need to meet those specifications while designing analog filter, low pass, the high pass and band pass filters as such, by using a suitable mathematical algorithms like Butterworth approximation method and Chebyshev approximation method, where you should able to understand what all those with respect to theory, and try to implement on the MATLAB programming. So these are the different course outcomes for this particular lab course, where starting from signal manipulations till the design of a filter, students will able to perform all these using MATLAB. So again, these are the experiments that we conduct in this particular lab. So that's what I told you, right from a basic signal processing of operations, how to implement or how to write a program for impulse function, how to write a program for exponential signal, how to write the DSBSC, how to generate a DSBSC waveform. All these are the basic signal operations that we studied initially. Then again, response of the LTI systems. When I say that response of the LTI systems is nothing but a convolution operations, that we try to see that also. We'll try to write a logic at one end. Another end, we also have some built-in functions in the MATLAB directly, where you can in a single line you can also observe the LTI response of a system. And also the same thing is true with the computation of DFT and IDFT. I can write a logic for that based on my the fundamental equation of DFT, or else I can also use the single built-in function that is present in the MATLAB. Here the students will come to know about the one thing, you improve your logical thinking. Apart from that, whatever you write a program, whether your answer, whatever the answer that you are getting is correct or not, that you can also verify using the built-in functions. So followed by computation, followed by the properties are going to be verified in the same experiment. Then again, one of the application of DFT, where we could able to see the frequency analysis of a given signal. And then followed by, already this part is covered in for your division, like overlap add and overlap save method. The same thing, the linear filtering of long data sequences using DFT is nothing but overlap add method and overlap save method, where once again for overlap add and overlap save, you write the MATLAB scripting program and see to that how linear filtering is performed on MATLAB. So efficient computation of the DFT. Once again, this is one more example where fast Fourier transform we already learned, and where we reduce the number of multiplications, and as such in theoretically we learned about this. And again we have a different method where we can go for make the DFT much more efficient. So followed by for a given specifications, we try to design filters, and there are the one is analog IIR, digital IIR, and digital FIR filters. These three types of filters are going to be designed, and we write a program using MATLAB scripting. Okay, these are the different set of examples that we will going to see in the entire lab sessions, and these and then 10 experiments results in the results in your 1.5 credits, so that the students make sure that you understand the basic concepts of MATLAB well. And once you understand the basic concepts, again automatically you can write a simple program by making use of mathematical equations. Okay, so first and foremost, what I like to inform the students is you should have a strong mathematical equations understanding, and then put those mathematical equations in the form of programming. That's it. So you can write a program very easily, and you can also analyze the things very easily. These are a few reference books where we also have the same reference book for your theoretical purpose, and as madam already insisted about the Sanjit K. Mitra, it is one of the very good textbook where you also have the already code for MATLAB code. You can just type the programs and see to that how it works, analyze the output. That is one of the very important. You will get the output, no doubt, but many of the times you will not able to understand the output, why it is coming, or how, why the signal is moving like this as such. Okay, one more book, Lee Tan, is very good textbook for any fundamentals of the DSP and its applications, where in application part he tried to give stress more on the MATLAB programming also. For each and every experiment put here, you can also see the same kind of programs in Lee textbook also. Okay, these are the few textbooks. Go through these few textbook. Apart from the ProQuiz is one standard textbook for understanding your theoretical concepts. Okay, now quickly I will move for MATLAB. So I hope a few of you students have installed the MATLAB. For this present situation, right now you can just note down different things in your paper and pen, and then you can same thing you can try it out in the later stage. So I'll just. So these are the three main windows. When we open the MATLAB, you'll see this one window as a current working folder, and another one is command window, then workspace, command history. So when we start working with these MATLAB, most important I prefer is the command window. It is one the very helpful in understanding the different MATLAB built-in functions as such. So make sure that you will be using the command window most of the times, and even when you want to see the result, once again I'll go for the command window. Now the name itself says that command window, so I need to give the commands then in this particular window, so that it will execute automatically. And first thing, please make sure that MATLAB is an interpreter, so it will execute line by line. The codes are executed line by line. And once again, this is the workspace. In this workspace, which all the variables that are going to be used in the MATLAB programming. Say for examples, I want to calculate y is equal to a plus b. Here my variables are y, a, b. So all those variables are going to be listed in your in this workspace. If you are using around 10 or 15 variables, all the 10 to 15 variables will going to be present here. For later in point of time, if you want to have the reference which all the variables that have used and what are their respective values, all those values and the variable name can be viewed in this particular window. That is what we call it as a workspace. As I told you, we will be using some command based program. As it is, MATLAB is a command based program, then once again you will be using the different commands, and you will each and every command will going to be listed in this particular command history. Okay, so let me start with a very simple thing. As madam in the beginning, in the introduction, madam told you that how it is going to be differ from C programming, or how it is very near to C programming, and how do you declare the variables. As in case of C programming, we know that in the declaration of the variables needs a data type. When I say that data type, say for example, it may be a integer data type or floating point data type or character data type. So you need to say that whether it is a int, float or character like that, right? So unless you give a instruction whether the given variable is a int or float or a character variable, the C compiler will not able to understand the things, and you will going to get an error if you don't specify the preferred data type for the variable, right? So MATLAB is not such cases. MATLAB is so intelligent, like the moment you write a is equal to 2, let me say that a is equal to 2. So this itself will give you the understanding that it is as good as you already see this in the Python also. The same case is true with MATLAB also. You need not to specify a variable whether it is an integer or the floating point data type or character. I can give and observe here, as I told you, in the workspace I declared a as a variable in my command window, and the variable a value is 2. That is what the workspace importance is all about. So again, I want to perform simple addition here. Let me say I take one more variable with b, and I just give the value of 3.5. let me check whether it will work or not. So once again, as I told you, MATLAB is an interpreter. Immediately it will give me a answer here itself, b is equal to 3.5. so let me check whether I can able to perform the addition of these two or not, because one variable where a is float data type of integer, and b I'm trying to declare a input with having a floating point data type. Now I'm trying to add one with one integer and one floating point. This was not possible in your C programming unless you make a type casting there. One of the variable is integer and another variable is floating point here, and this is as simple as that, where you need not to specify any data types. That's what the madam told in the beginning. How do you declare the variables in this? So similarly, you can observe, let me take another variable, s is equal to capital A. So I'll just write this in a single inverted quote, and I'll say that s is equal to A. Here s is going to be taken as a character data type, right? So these are the few things that what you need to do, what you need to understand. And basically MATLAB it stands for matrix, MAT stands for matrix, LAB stands for laboratory. So it is called as a matrix laboratory. The reason why we call it as a matrix laboratory, because when I say that A is equal to 2, it automatically read it in the form of matrix. You may ask me, how sir? So since it is as good as I represent this in this fashion, what do you observe here? I put it in a big bracket. What do you observe here? Which is nothing but this element A consisting of one row and one column. That's it. So this is how it is going to be read inside the MATLAB. Okay. So where this particular value is going to be read as a 2×1×1 matrix. So similarly, if I want to write the linear vector, so 1 2 3 4, now how the MATLAB treat it as, so it take this as, so how many columns here, 1 2 3 4 columns and a single row, therefore 1×4 matrix, right? So now these are the few fundamental things. So how I declare the variables, how I can go for the performing the addition, and also if you want to perform here I took only single operator, that is plus operator. You can go and check for the other operators like minus, multiplication operator. As such, we have two different multiplications in this case. You that we will going to see which is that two types of multiplications in this case very soon. And if I want to declare this once again, the 2×2 matrices, then how do you declare? So just look at this very carefully. So I want to declare, so this is previous value was with respect to, so 4 columns and 1 row. Now I want to make 2 columns and 2 row, 2×2 matrix. So I just write, let me take an example of 4 and 5. Okay, then put a semicolon, which indicates that I am trying to go for the second row. This ends when I put a semicolon, that means that this is going to fit, this value 4 and 5 value must be fitted in the first row, and second row elements, let me write 1 and 2. So now you observe how it will display a value as. So look at this. So A value clearly indicates that 2×2 matrices here, where the first row consisting of 4 and 5, the second row consisting of 1 and 2. Similarly, if I want to increase my x equal to, I'll take another variable. So now I want to go for 3×3 matrices. How do you arrive? So I take a simple values 1, 2, 3. Okay, first row complete, then what I should put? So let me put a semicolon, then once again 4, 5, 6. So this is the second row element. Once again I'll put a semicolon, then 1, okay, now 7 8 9, so close the bracket. Now observe carefully how the output is going to be displayed, right? So now I you practice the different types of matrices, 2×2 matrices, square matrix or any rectangular matrix, where 2×3 matrix. As such, then try to write this in have a practice of writing the different types of practice matrices here. Then you will going to get a different way of describing the matrices here. Okay, then now you could able to see that in the command window it is rushing off or rushing with all of the different variables, and I cannot able to see the the other variables in a neat, and it is not neat now. So I want to clear all my command window. There are two important windows now. Till now we have declared, we understood the declaration of the variables, addition of the two different variables, and how to write a 2×2 matrices and 3×2 matrices or 3×3 matrices as such. Now I'll make use of few commands that are present in built-in functions that are present in the MATLAB. Slowly I'll take you to usage of the MATLAB built-ins. Now I want to clear these particular command window. I want to clear only command window. Then CLC is the built-in command that we will going to be use to just to clear. It is just to rub my command window. Okay, now you can see that it cleared my entire command window. Do you mean to say that all the values are going to be deleted? No, it is not as such. You still type a X, you can go to the workspace, you still have the value of yes, A, B, C, X. You just type X and see what happens. So still the values are present, but it is going to clear my command window. Now the question is, no sir, I want to clear my entire variables also. What is the command window that command, what is the MATLAB command that we have? So CLC, as I told you, it is to just to clear the window. Now you observe that I will make use of one more built-in function, that is clear all. Now observe carefully in the workspace, you don't find any of the variables that is going to be present in once I type this clear all and then I say that enter. Now observe carefully, so all the values that are present in my workspace are got deleted. Now just I press X, X is going to be undefined variable now, because since I used the clear all instruction or the built-in function, so it cleared all earlier data. Now I say that X equal to 1 and 2. Now it will going to take a new value. Okay. Now I just have one more very important instruction in the MATLAB. Let me take a simple value here, 2.5, and now I'll put a semicolon. What happens? Now look at this. Now I'll remove the semicolon. What happens? Just see. So semicolon in C it was different. Semicolon, usage of semicolon in MATLAB, it is different. What did you observe in these two steps? Initially when I put a semicolon, it will not display the value of A, which means it holds or it hides the content that is present in the variable A. The moment I write A equal to 2.5 and I remove the semicolon, it will display the content of that particular variable. Here the variable I took is A equal to 2.5. It will not go into hide. It simply displays the content of A. So that is what the difference between putting the semicolon and if you don't put the semicolon. Most of the time students will confuse with respect to C programming, where in C programming you must put a semicolon unless it will not terminate that particular line. Here it is not so. Here it is whether you want to show that content of that particular variable or you don't want to show the content of that particular variable, that decides by putting the semicolon or not putting the semicolon. Am I clear here? So once again, the one more very important point is, so if I say let me say a b equal to 3, then I will going to perform a plus b. See to that, on the left hand side I am not using whether y equal to a plus b or z equal to a plus b, but still whether I am going to get the answer or not, that I am going to check. Look at this, still it is giving me the answer. 2.5 plus 3 is 5.5, but look at the variable that it has used, ans. Ans is the default variable that is present in my MATLAB. So it is not the variable that declared by the programmer or me here. It is by default MATLAB will choose. If you don't specify, say for example, as you all the time we will be writing on the left hand side a y equal to a plus b or y equal to a into b as such, if you don't declare, then by default MATLAB will be having one default variable. That variable we call it as ans. I hope this particular point is also cleared. So what we discussed in this, so again the importance of applying the semicolon and not applying the semicolon, and one more point, what happens if you don't write the left hand side variable? By default default variable of a MATLAB is this ans. Okay, now the another value, well let me take 2x2 matrix, and here now I put a semicolon at this end. So what this semicolon indicates? This semicolon indicates to differentiate the first row and the second row. Okay, then this end of the semicolon, end of the semicolon indicates just to not to display or hide the content of variable A. So that is what the meaning here, not to confuse with this particular semicolon and this semicolon. Then one more important point. So I just say A, and it as I know the content, the size of the matrix is 2x2, but still I want to check whether the size is really 2x2 or not. So there is a MATLAB built-in command that is called as size. So size of is a function. Just make use of this size of what? Size of A. What is that A? A is a variable. I say that 1, 2 and 3, 4. Now if you observe ANS, ANS is a default variable. Here I have not given any left-hand side variable. By default, now it is choosing it as a ANS. 2 and 2. What do you mean by 2 and 2? So that's what 2x2 matrices, right? So similarly, you can check for rest of the matrix. So where we'll try to use the size as a function, MATLAB built-in function, which will give me the matrix size of this particular variable. Am I clear here? Okay. So now with this, I'll just go to the scripting language. These are all the command window just for your practice purpose. Okay, whenever you have a doubt whether this will work or not, so I'll just make use of the MATLAB. One more very important command I'll teach you, then I'll move with the MATLAB scripting. Okay, so this is one of the very important command, that is MATLAB help. All the time it saves me if I don't know the any inbuilt function or syntax part. Say for example, I want to check help size. As I told you, size is a MATLAB function, right? Help size, what is the meaning of this? I just say help and just say size. Look at this, what how the output is going to be displayed by making use of a help. It will going to display the meaning of size, how to use this with respect to syntax in case of MATLAB. So here it is taking time. Let me wait for a few seconds. Okay, now that's fantastic. Now look at this, size of an array. So the array that we declare here for m cross n matrix, say x, so it will going to give me a size of that particular array. That is what the meaning. And here a simple example they have given. So you can also go through these examples. Then if you're not able to convince by this, there is one more clear documentation reference page with a browser window. Click on this. It will take you to the more explanation part of this particular function. Okay, so I'm telling you this size is a built-in function. When I say that function, it should have some parameters that I should pass. So all the time when you write, it should be size of, which means anything that you take, so you must pass some parameters here or variable names. Okay, so as in case of C programming, how you use the function name, in the similar way you should use the function syntax in MATLAB also. That is what the similarity about the usage of functions in C as well as in MATLAB. Okay, now let me take you to the another window that we call it as a scripting window. Here I cannot able to save my program, and I simply go on writing the program, but I cannot save my program. This is most of the time I will use the command window as a rough work. Okay, if I don't know the syntax or if I don't know whether this particular function will work or not, I will be using the command window, and if it works, okay, then I will come back to my the scripting window, and then I will make use of those built-in functions. So most of the times, as I told you, so this will help me as a rough work. And once again, I'll make use of the clear all. So in the most of the times in the programming, when I start writing a fresh program, make sure that you use CLC and clear all, because if I don't use that clear all, maybe some of your friend using the same computer, he will be using a equal to 10, 20 as such, and you start using A in your particular programming, it will be present in my workspace, it takes that particular variable itself. So what I should do, before starting a program, make sure that you will use these two built-in functions, that is CLC and clear all. Now in the home MATLAB at the top left corner, you can able to observe a new, create new document, or just click on this. So here I'll choose a script. So now here you start writing the program, and this particular example is just to read the inputs and then calculate, go for simple addition and multiplication operation, and see how output how do you save this editor window, and then how to watch the output. Okay, so that's where I'll put to obtain sum of two variables. Okay, so let me write a program, and variable A you can declare as a 10, and I put a semicolon, and B equal to 20. So let me see what happens if I don't put a semicolon for B, and then I say that Y is equal to A plus B. Okay, now so very simple program. I'll save this program. To save this program, go to a save option here. And very important point in this, you make any one working folder. Okay, so working folder, and always have a habit of starting with some my or example as such, because there are n number of built-in functions in MATLAB. Say for example, if I write a sum of this, sum is a built-in function that is present in a MATLAB. So you know that the basic fundamental programming language says that never use basic built-in functions to save your program, because it will clash many of the times, and it thinks that this sum is going to be a the built-in function. So what we need to do, so all the time I use the prefix my sum, my DFT as such. Okay, so this is followed by .m extension. .m stands for MATLAB. So that's why we call it as most of the times m scripting. Okay, so mysum.m, and now you save this program. Make sure that you don't use any of the built-in functions. So whenever you want to use, make sure that you make use of this many of the times I use examples ex underscore sum. Okay, so as such. Okay, then you save the program with .m. Now the program is saved. You can observe here, earlier it was untitled, now this got replaced with exam underscore ex underscore sum dot m. Okay, now let me run the function. How do you run the function? In the command window, you never used this run command, right? So the moment you press enter, it will show you the output. Now whatever write a program in scripting, you must run this program by clicking on a symbol play button that is present on your MATLAB. Okay, click on this, and you just say add to path. Okay, now you can see here, b equal to 20, because here semicolon is not present. The value of a is not displayed because I have I used semicolon, stating that not to display this value. Okay, now I once again while displaying why also I have not put a semicolon, hence directly it is giving me the answer. Let me check what happens if I put semicolon to all. Okay, and once again I'll save the program, rerun the program. Now look at this, make some observation here. Your variable workspace variable name is also same, have not changed. Okay, and command window is not clear, so previous values are also present. But now if I want to check what is the value of y, then once again I just press y in the output, and now so it is little bit confusing which is the previous execution and which is the second time execution, right? So this confusion, in order to avoid this confusion, so every time you write a program, make sure that you put a clear screen. Every time it executes, it will clear. The first instruction that is present in your program is CLC. Whenever it start executing, it clears the window. And again, so every time I should okay, let me take up this in the next during the next iteration. I'll just run this program. Now you observe the command window, it automatically clears. Okay, but workspace still have the same value. Now once you run this program, now you say that y, it is going to give me the value. What is the content of a? Just press a and enter, and press b and say enter. It will show you the content of a and b. Okay, now I want to clear the variable names also and variable content also. Now how do you do it? Now it is clear all. So clear first instruction will clear you the command window. Next instruction clears all the variable that is present in your program. So just run this. Now observe carefully. Okay. Okay. Okay, the moment you write clear all, then it will be clearing the previous values. But since the values are different, once it start executing, it will be displaying the same value in the workspace. Now observe carefully, here a equal to 10 and here a equal to 10. Now as I told you, I am trying to clear this. I'll just change the value from a equal to 30. Now right now it has not been executed with respect to a equal to 30. Now just I run this, and I will be using this a instead of a, I will be using this c, and here I will be using a c plus b. Now the moment I run this program, it will clear my a value. It will not show the value of a. Okay, you just see here. Okay, which means a got clear. It is because of my usage of clear all built-in function. Okay, so just observe carefully. I'll make use of a equal to 20, a equal to 10. A equal to 10, and I don't use this clear all. Now it will going to have this in the previous values will be going to be present in this case. So I'll just say c equal to, so the clear indication of clear all is just to clear your variables. That's it. Okay. And now if I want to, now I'll just take up a few another examples where we'll try to go for some input. If I want to read the input from user, say, okay, I'll just paste this program. Parallelly I will be explaining you the program. Okay. So there are a few more instructions here. I'll just take this. Now if I want to read the input from the user, now in this program I want to read the input from the user. So I have another built-in function called input. Input is a built-in function where I try to take the input from my users. Okay, now I'll just simply run this program, see what happens. It is giving me the printf statement. It is just like a printf statement here. So and it will say that input, what it does, it take this value and it will put into the variable called a. I'll just write a equal to it. It is asking me a 3x3 matrix. I just say 3x3 matrix. I'll enter here. So let me see here. So if you see here, earlier variables got washed out due to usage of the clear all, and now there exists a new variable. So if I press capital A, it will going to display me a 3x3 matrix. Similarly, I want to perform the addition of two matrix. Let me say, now what I should do, I will make use of this same matrix. I will call once again and I'll say here b is equal to enter the and one more 3x3 matrix. Okay, so now and after that I say y is equal to a plus b. Now I'll want to perform this output. Now let me see how it works. Okay, I'll run the program. So I'll make use of the same inputs here. Okay, once again I'll take instead of 1, 2, 3, I'll take 1, 1, 1 so that it will help me to analyze the results. Okay. So now look at this. Enter the matrix A. Okay, here it is enter the matrix B. So whatever you type in the single inverted quote, so it will going to display the same here. Earlier it was enter the 3x3 matrix A. The same thing was copied down. So once again in the second matrix also it displayed as it is. Now once again I rerun this program and you see here enter the matrix A. I just enter. Now you can observe this, the second statement got executed, that is enter the 3x3 matrix B. Okay, so once again I'll make sure that the same matrix is entered. Okay, now what it performed, it already performed y equal to, you observe in the workspace you got a value y, but it is not displayed here. The reason is semicolon. And if you want to know the content of y, you just press capital Y and say enter, so it will show you the output. So you, if you perform the addition of these two matrix, you will going to get this answer. Once again, there is one more function that is called as a disp of Y. Let me see what this particular display function will going to do. So once again save the program, run it. So it will be asking every time when I type, it will be asking me a input value. So once again I'll just say enter, and automatically see here I have not pressed Y. The moment I gave a matrix A and matrix B, it is displaying my value Y, right? So display function displays the variable content. That's it. Now I just say here what, let me say disp of matrix A is. Okay, okay, and I'll put it in a single inverted quote, then I say disp of A. Now we will see how the output varies. Okay, even by putting the semicolon for disp, since the job of disp itself to display, even if you put a semicolon or not putting a semicolon, it will not make a much difference. The job of disp itself is to display the content. So now you can observe here, I'll just run this once again, enter the value. Now look at this. The moment I write this input, the matrix A is, it is displaying the matrix A, content of matrix A. Now once again it is asking me to enter the 3x3 matrix B. So I write, so it will not going to display the second matrix, as I have not wrote these two functions, these two lines after B. So hence it is right now it is displaying only the content of A, and it is displaying the content of A matrix. So finally, if I want to display the same thing of matrix B and matrix Y, I just copy paste, and now I will say matrix B is, okay, matrix B is, and then display B. Okay, now I say Y is equal to A plus B. Now observe carefully how the output changes. So here it will going to display the content of matrix A. Now once again I'll enter the second matrix. So it is telling me matrix B is, and since I have not used the slash n, so here itself it is giving me the answer, that is Y, matrix Y. Okay, so if you want to make a different thing, like you can say matrix Y is, okay, then you can run, and once again it will display you matrix Y is as a statement, then it will give you the final answer. Similarly, you can perform multiplication of the matrix and division of the two matrices, a subtraction of the two matrices. That's what we call it as a operator, different matrix operator. So I will be sharing you this particular folder in the Google Classroom. You can just copy and paste and see to that how it varies. Okay, now there are two types of multiplication, as I told you. I'll just show you those two types of multiplication operation in a command window, and later on you write a program for it. So see, okay, let me take a two inputs here. A equal to 2 cos 2 matrix, simple. So, and B is equal to, so how do you write a second matrix? So let me take once again 1 comma 3 and 4 comma 5. 4 comma 5. Okay, now I want to perform a multiplication. Y is equal to A star B. What happens, just observe here. So I'll display the multiplication operation has already performed. I'll just say Y is equal. Now Y is equal to, just go for the multiplication of two matrices of 2 cross 2 matrix. Just verify whether you are going to get this answer or not. So definitely it will going to give you the matrix operation, because this is one. Write down the matrix and see here itself. I'll print A and I'll print B. So this is 1 is multiplied with this matrix, this value. And then you go for matrix multiplication operation and see to that you will going to get 9, 13, 14, 21 or not. Okay. Now I'll use one more method. I want to multiply element by element, which means a first element of first matrix into first element of second matrix, 1 into 1. I should get 1. Then I take a second element in the first matrix and second element in the second matrix, 2 into 3, I should get 6. Similarly, 2 into 4, I should get 8. 3 into 5, I should get 15. This is called as elementary element by element multiplication. So for which I will be using, let me take Z is equal to Y dot star is the operator. where a into dot star b. So you just observe here what will be the output of that. You just observe here, look at this. This is 1 into 1, that is what, 1. 2 into 3, 6. 2 into 4, 8. 3 into 5, 15. So what is the difference between dot star and star operator? So there are two operators. Look at this, one is dot star and another one is simply a star operator. Dot star is a element by element multiplication operator, and star is a matrix multiplication operator symbol. Is this clear to all of you? So you just try this. I have given you this particular, I will be going to share you this Word document. Here we have done a matrix operations. So where we try to let the matrix A and B, we try to display them. Then further, I'll just go with different arithmetic and operations like addition, subtraction, followed by multiplications and the element by element multiplication also. Okay. Now I'll just take you to one more example, where now we'll start with actual generation of a sinusoidal waveform and simple impulse functions as such. Okay. I hope till here everyone got a clear picture. Let me come back to the Google Meet and let me check if you have any doubts. You can post it in your chat box. Okay, madam is not madam is having a class of I square IT. Okay, now any doubts, guys? Any doubts? Or else another half an hour, I'll be taking you to the one more very important part. Okay, thank you. I hope you all are following the lecture. So little bit I'm going slow. The reason is most of the students probably not aware of MATLAB sometimes. So little bit I'm going slow here. I hope you are following the lecture. Okay, thank you. So what we dealt in this particular example. So in this particular example, you learnt about the reading the matrix, 3x3 matrix, reading the matrix using a built-in function called input, and how to display the content of the matrix. One way of displaying the output is by just typing the variable. If not, you can use the disp built-in function to display the answers. Okay. Then second important point is different arithmetic operators. It is as simple as using the addition, subtractions, and two types of multiplication operation. One is normal matrix multiplication and another one is element by element multiplication, that is star and dot star operator. So this is what we learnt in this particular example. Okay, now I will move to the next example here. Let me clear the screen. So to clear the screen, I have CLC. To clear all the contents variable, I have CLEAR all, clear all. Now, okay, as I told you, if I want to display the content of A, let me come back to command window. That is where we this is how I will be using, or I will be shifting from the M scripting to command window, because most of the times, as I told you, I will be using this as a rough page. Okay, now I want to generate, or I want to feed only even numbers into A. So how do you do it? So okay, you just write 2, 4, 6, 8, 10. Okay, this is fine, where I try to write only even numbers. Okay, if I want to generate 1 to 10, how do you write? Write this is where like x equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Like this, you keep on writing the elements, like 1 to 10 elements it is going to be displayed. Now the question is, I want to generate x equal to the value running from 1 to 100. Listen my question, I want to generate x equal to a numbers starting from 1 to 100. How do you do it? It is not possible to type like this, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so on up till 100, right? So in MATLAB, I have a simple operations like, that's what a for loop, that's what we say, where I just write the starting value I equal to 0 and I less than 100, I plus plus. Is it not? Similarly, here also, the MATLAB has given a very fantastic the looping structure. You need not to write that even a for, I just say 1. Up till what you need? Colon. Put a colon. Okay? Just say 100. So this is a very kind of the very simple method of for loop, where automatically this colon indicates that I should increment by 1. You type it or not, you don't type it, just it will increment the value by 1, and let us see how the output varies. Now see here, it is going to generate 100 elements right from 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 value, second column 10 value, up till 100 values are going to be generated. Now out of these 100 values, x equal to 100, out of these 100 values in a y, I need only odd numbers. How do you write this odd numbers? Put a logic, that's it. What is the value that you need? Okay, let me take you to another thing. In steps of odd numbers I need, let me take, I have... I'll compress this value once again. Let me, instead of taking 1 to 100, I just take 1 to 10 so that you will understand very clearly. So let me take it. Okay, now 1 to 10. So in these 1 to 10 elements, I want to fetch only even numbers. This x is an array consisting of 10 elements. I want to fetch only odd numbers. So let me take y equal to, what is the first odd number? 1. How many steps you need to skip? So 1, next element will be 3, which means that after 1 it will going to be, so by adding 2 we are going to get 3, right? In steps of 2, I just say, in steps of 2 till the last value is 9, right? So it means that it will jump 2 steps and then it will fetch the value 3. See, the initial value is 1. It is the value how much number you want to jump or how much value you want to increment. From here, after 2 steps, 1, 2, the third element is going to be displayed. 1, 2, the fourth element is going to be, fifth element is going to be displayed. Just observe carefully here. Look at this output. 1, 3, 5, 7 and 9. Is it not? So that's what. So here y is equal to, I just say z equal to, I just say x in the value of x, I want to fetch 2 to 5, only 2 to 5 I want to fetch. So how do you do it? 2, initial value I want 2, okay, and in steps of 1. You write this or you don't write for a single step, it will not make a much difference. Or here I'll write, see here, both the way I'll write. I want to fetch till 5. You need to get the output 2, 3, 4, 5, right? Look at this. initial value. Okay, I'll just take it to here. 2, 3, 4, 5. Now I remove this one. What happens? Still it works same. But when I say that, when I want to say only even numbers are required. Only even numbers means first even number is 2. In steps of how much I should write? 2, right? The next value will be after, it should skip the middle number, then it should move for the second value. So initially I should get the 2, and then I'll skip this, that is including this value 1 and 2. Two steps, after two steps it will fetch the next value. So till how many values? Till 10. So it is going to display only even number ranging from 1 to 10. Am I clear in this part? Okay. Now I'll just fetch the content from the array. Now still now I have not told you how to fetch the content from the array. So I'll just display, let me take x equal to 1 to 10. I want to fetch 5, only a one element, that is 5. So that is y is equal to x of 5. Look at this. What is the content? X of 5 is 5. So this is how I try to fetch the content from the array that is going to be displayed. Say for example, if you have a confusion, because since the value is also same, let me take 10 10 20 30 40 50 60. Okay, let me take these values. Okay, now I want to say y is equal to x of second element. So what should be the output here? 20, right? So this is how I want to perform the addition of these values. I want to perform the addition of 30 and 60. So look at this. This is third element and sixth element. So is it not possible? Yes, it is possible. I say y is equal to x of third value should be added with x of sixth value. So I should get 30, and when I have 30 and 60, I'll get 90, right? So x of 3 plus x of 6. The final value is y equal to 90. So similarly, the same kind of operation that you can go for with respect to addition, subtraction, multiplication as such. Okay. So this is all different operations that is going to be performed with respect to arrays and matrices. Okay, now here I'll move to in execution of sinusoidal waveform. Why I wanted to stress is, now I want to generate y is equal to, now I want to generate a sinusoidal waveform where I need to know the mathematical expression, right, to obtain y is equal to a sine theta or a sine of omega t, right? So this is the mathematical equation. A sine omega t is a mathematical equation. I just want to give a different value of t, and omega is equal to 2 pi f, right? So where, and omega is equal to 2 star pi star f. Right. So look at this. The MATLAB is also having one more very important feature. The moment you write pi, there are few things automatically it will going to display. The moment you write a pi, it is going to give me the answer of the value of pi. Right. So this is one of the fantastic thing. You can also write Avogadro number. Just find it out which is the built-in function if you want to display the Avogadro number in the MATLAB command window. Now I'll just type, how do you write the MATLAB program? Let me systematically go on writing this. So I'll just display. Take a first a value. I just say a equal to 1. Units of amplitude, then I need to multiply w, that is 2 pi f. So again I need to take the value of f. I just declare the value of f is supposed to be 1 hertz once again, and W is equal to 2 star pi star f. This is how I try to see here. First thing, I should multiply W equal to 2 pi f. Before to that, I should have f value, right? So I declared f equal to 1 units. So now I say that W equal to 2 star pi star f. What is W now? 2 pi f value, I got it. Now, the next thing is y from if you observe carefully, the along the x-axis, the sinusoidal waveform is plotted for the various time value t. Is it not 0.01, 0.02? In steps of t value, I say t equal to 0 in steps of 0.01 up till 1 or 1. So till here, I need to generate sine of W star t, right? A star W star t. Is it not? Look at this. This is the fundamental definition. So I'll post it. Y is equal to, okay, for each value of t. T, it will take 0, it will calculate the y value. T increment by 0.01, it will take the 0.01 and then multiply with W, and again it will fetch that particular value. So like this, I will be plotting, and we have a built-in function called sine, and sine of this value I'm going to put, and now y is going to be plotted for sinusoidal waveform. Next, I have one more built-in function called plot, and now I say that I want to plot the y value. Okay, plot y, and now see how the output varies. Just run the program. Now look at this. Right. So what we did in steps of 0.1, in steps of 0.1, the along the x-axis, I just took a y equal to a sine omega t. I should declare what the value of amplitude as 1, and you can observe here, look at this, the amplitude is 1. If you see the peak amplitude, it is 1, right? So similarly, it is going to plot me a sinusoidal waveform. No, sir, I want to plot cosine waveform. Okay, now I just change this from sine to cos. Okay, now run the program. Now look at this. Cos of 0 is 1, right? So cosine wave starts from like this. In case of sinusoidal waveform, if you observe, it was from 0. Sine of 0 value. The moment you put this t equal to 0, the entire thing becomes 0. Sine of 0 is 0. So first value, it must start with 0 itself. Look at this. So hence, it is called as a sinusoidal waveform. The moment for the first value, if you put cos value, cos of 0 will going to get a into cos 0, that is 1. So maximum amplitude I should get. So run the program and observe carefully how it is going to plot it along the y-axis. So now, sir, I want to display both sinusoidal waveform and cosine waveform. Still it is possible. I just copy this program and then plot, then I'll say sine. So observe carefully what happens now. I cannot take the same variable, right? Y is plotted for cos and y is plotted for sine. Now I say that z is equal to the output. Y stands for cosine wave, output z stands for this one. I have to plot z. Let me see what happens for the output. Run the program. Still it is plotting only sinusoidal waveform, because the latest signal, the latest line was with respect to sine wave. It was executed, it was plotted, but it is not getting displayed because the next instruction, the latest instruction is with respect to sine and I am trying to plot set, right? So it is plotting, but I am not able to see this. So that is what we have, a one more instruction called hold on. So it will execute, it is plotting, but it is not getting displayed. So that's where I say just hold on. And now you can observe the output. I can able to see both the waveforms now. Look at this, a sinusoidal waveform as well as cosine waveform is going to be displayed by making use of hold on operator, hold on built-in function, which means that it is executed. Since I am trying to say only one value, so hence it is not getting displayed here, hence I will be using the hold on signal, right? Now observe carefully what happens if I want to see the discrete output, and we have a one more instruction or one more built-in function step. Now for cosine wave it will be plotting as a CT function, and for stem it is going to plot it as a DT function, DT values. Now look at this. I'll just rerun the program. Okay, observe carefully the sinusoidal waveform. Look at this. I say z equal to a sin omega t stem of z, so that I am getting a discretized value of sinusoidal waveform, whereas still for plotting the cosine wave I still use the plot function so that it is showing me the CT function itself. Instead of this, if I want to see in the form of discretized values, look at this, how the output going to be changed. Is this clear? So in this particular program you got to know how to generate a simple sinusoidal waveform by making use of the concept of y, mathematical equation y equal to a sin omega t, and how to plot both signals in a single waveform, in a single figure window. Okay, now I just make one more function. I want to see individual values at each line. So I'll just make use of grid on, how it varies. Just observe here, grid on. Now look at this, at this instant of value what is the value? At this value, that line number, at 40th value, what is the value I want to see? So this is not possible in this picture, right? So that's where grid means what? What is the meaning of grid? Put a line individually, that's it. So run this, observe carefully. Now you can able to see this, what is the value here and what is the value that is going to be present at this time instant. So this is x-axis is time and y-axis is amplitude. That if I don't write this for a third person, how come he will come to know that what is x-axis and what is y-axis, right? So I need to write what is x-axis and what is y-axis. Now I should make use of another function here, x label. You just type this, what is the, so it is time. Now this is x label means what is x axis is all about. Then again, right now, if you write like this, any third person, when he or she watches your output, they will come to know about your teachers or in during the lab exams, they will come to know about what is all about x-axis and y-axis. Now look at this, what I wrote inside the these two functions, that is what is going to be displayed here. Okay, amplitude, look at this, y-axis y-label, it is going to be displayed as amplitude, and x-axis time, right? So this labeling can be done by making use of x label and y label. Am I clear? Yeah. Now I want to display what this particular figure, entire figure, talk about. So I just say there is one more function called legend. So it is sine wave slash cosine wave. I just okay. What do you mean by legend? It is title that what I am trying to give for this particular figure. Okay, just observe carefully here how it going to be, how this function going to change my output. It is taking some time. Okay, now look at this. So this is legend is going to give me the sinusoidal waveform and cosine waveform. This is just the name of this particular figure. As I told you, it is giving me that. That's it. Is this clear? Is this clear? Okay, now I just want to differentiate the two plots here, right? So I have a stem and followed by, I'll just make use of another signal, another color. So slash r in a plotting, while plotting system stem of z, I just say r stands for make use of another color by red. So now observe carefully how the output is going to be changed. Now the sinusoidal waveform, what I am trying to display using the stem function, stem of this function z, and I am trying to make this the change in the color. You can go to help colors, you will get to know about a different color sets that what you can use, where you can use for a different set of figure windows. Okay, okay, now this is all about generating a sinusoidal waveform and cosine waveform. I'll take up a last example and we'll wind up the session for the day. Okay, where I just give you one more example where I want to generate the impulse function. I want to generate impulse function. Say for example, okay, for similarly, I'll just give you a few of the homework here. You can change this a into e power at or exponential exp of t. Okay, you can generate this. Exp is a built-in function where you can generate exponential rising signal and exponential decaying signal. Just check what happens by putting negative inside the exp function and by removing exp, by removing negative sign inside the exp function. Just perform this and see how the exponential signals are going to be varied. Is this clear? Okay, now few more concepts I wanted to deal about. I think it's already 10:30, 1.5 hour. Probably you are draining out with a lot of contents with respect to MATLAB and I hope it is not too much for you. Let me come back to the chat box, and if you have any doubts, let me clear here. Shall we stop for the day, and we'll have this once again in some other session whenever you are free. Or else, are you free on Friday afternoon? This Friday afternoon. Amit, you can unmute and talk to me.
Yes, sir. Friday afternoon, I'm free.
Is that okay, Allah? Friday afternoon. So from the next session, I will be moving little fast, as this was the first lab session for you guys. Of course, many of you have done this in your signals and system lab. But still, most of the students are having a one semester gap, so that some points you may not able to catch in the previous semester. So I thought of going with all the detailed explanation. Any doubts in the today's session? If not, we'll wind up the session. And the next class, we will have it on Friday afternoon. Okay?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.